Hey everybody, this is Jerry. Welcome back to the Auto Layout video tutorial series. iOS 9 added some great tools for working with auto layout in code. In this tutorial, you'll learn about using UILayoutGuide as a replacement for dummy views and container views, and NSLayoutAnchor for simpler syntax when dealing with constraints in code. You've seen in previous video tutorials in this series that to center a group of views, we had to use a container view to group those views together and apply the vertical center constraint to the group. Now you can do that grouping with UILayoutGuide. It's also useful for creating constraints on the space between views. Previously, if you wanted to create an equal width constraint, for example, on the space between views, you had to create clear dummy views with no content and apply the constraints to those views. This added the overhead of rendering and participating in the messages sent between views in the view hierarchy just for the purposes of layout. Now you can create a UI layout guide and constraints between it and the views without that additional overhead. This is only available in code, so if you're working in Interface Builder, you may choose to still use container and dummy views, or you can create most of your layout in Interface Builder and just add the guides and their constraints in code. Even if you're not creating your own UI layout guides, you may want to interact with a couple of properties on UI view that are UI layout guides. The layout margins guide property of a view represents that view's margins. On a top level view, the margin cannot be customized and is set by the system to 16 or 20 points on the sides and 0 at the top and bottom. On any view other than the top level view, the margins default to 8 points on each edge, but this margin can be customized if you want to change it. The layout margins guide allows you to create constraints to these margins rather than to the edge of the view. Readable content guide is a new concept in iOS 9. The width of this guide is changed by the system depending on the user's selection of font size. Its purpose is to help improve readability and legibility of large blocks of text. For smaller font sizes, it's hard to keep track of which line is next if the block of text is too wide. But with larger font sizes, if the block of text is too narrow, the user has to scan back and forth too frequently. This guide helps solve that problem by adjusting its width depending on the font size. NSLayoutAnchor is a new way of creating constraints on views. Instances of NSLayoutAnchor are not created directly, but are properties on UIView and UILayoutGuide. There are anchor properties for all the attributes you would create constraints from or to. Note that there are not anchor properties on UIView for margins. Instead, you would get the layout margins guide property of a view and use the anchor properties on it. So let's see an example. Instead of using the NSLayout constraint initializer like this, you would write the code like this. Button1.topAnchor.constraint equal to anchor topLayoutGuide.bottomAnchor with a constant of 20. There is a version of this method without the constant as well. So if the constant is 0, you can just leave that parameter off. And there are versions for greater than or equal to and less than or equal to. You can see how, especially with many lines of code, this becomes much more readable and easy to follow. It also provides type checking to keep you from mistakenly creating a constraint between an attribute on the x-axis, like leading edge, with an attribute on the y-axis, like top.
For this demo, we're going to take the project from the challenge in tutorial 2, and we're going to reproduce this using code and UI layout guide and NS layout constraint. I'm just opening the project from the challenge in video 2. And to make this simple, I'm just going to delete everything in Interface Builder. Let's switch over to our code. Give ourselves some room to type here. So first we're going to create each of those views and add them to the super view. And again, we're going to set translates auto resizing mask into constraints to false right away after we create each of our views. Then we're going to set the text of this to first name. And we'll add it to our super view. So we'll create each of these labels and then we'll create the text field that goes with it. We want the style of this to be a rounded rect. Let's do the same thing for our last name label. And the last name text field. We have all of our labels and text fields created. Let's create the two buttons for the bottom. Okay, now that all the boring stuff is out of the way, let's start by creating a new layout guide. This is going to replace the container view that we saw in the challenge previously. And we add that to our view, similar to what we would for a subview. We use add layout guide. Instead of creating NS layout constraints directly, we're going to use anchors here to create our constraints. So we want the leading edge of the first name label constrained to the leading edge of the container. And we use the leading anchor property on the first name label to do that. You use constrain equal to anchor, and you can see we have greater than or equal or less than or equal, and we have variants for a constant or no constant. In this case, our constant is going to be zero, so we can leave it off. And we activate the constraint. It's that simple. And the syntax is a lot cleaner than creating NSLayout constraints with the initializer. Let's create constraints for the first name text field. Here's the anchor for the first baseline. We want to align the baseline with the label, so we use the first baseline anchor for that. The next constraint we'll create is to constrain the leading edge of the first name text field with the trailing edge of the first name label. In this case, we'll have a constant, so we're going to use this variant. And the constant is just 8. Then we want a top space constraint between the text field and the container. And a trailing space constraint between the text field and the anchor. Next, we're going to constrain the leading and trailing edges of all of the labels to the first name label. And I need 5 of these, so I'm just going to copy and paste here. That's the leading anchor. Let's do the trailing anchor as well. Now the leading edge and the trailing edge of each of the labels are constrained to the leading and the trailing edge of the first name label. Let's do the same thing for the text fields. Again, these are real similar, so I'm just going to copy and paste. And the trailing edge. Now I want to constrain the baseline of each set of label and text field, and then I want to constrain each text field to the text field directly above it. With a distance of 8. And I also want to constrain the bottom of my last text field, the real edge text field, to the container. Now, I have all of the views constrained relative to the container and to each other. I need to constrain the container itself to the super view. I want to constrain it to the margins, though. So rather than using the anchor properties on the super view, I'll use the layout margins guide on the super view. So I get a reference to the layout margins guide on the super view, and then I can create constraints to that. I want to center it. And I want to constrain its leading and trailing edge to the margin. Finally, let's constrain our buttons. We're also going to constrain the buttons to the margins, so we'll use the margins property here. In this case, I'm going to constrain the left button's bottom to the bottom layout guide, but I want it to be 20 points above the bottom layout guide, and I'm going to do that using a negative constant. Bottom layout guide is also a property on the view controller, so I can just use it directly here. And I want it to be 20 points above that. Again, I could have flipped these. I could have constrained the bottom layout guide to the left button and used a positive 20. But the way I think about it is the left button is 20 points less than the bottom layout guide. So I just used that to match my mental model. And finally, I want the right and left button to be equal widths, and so I can use the width anchor for that. Okay, if I haven't mistyped anything, let's build and run this and see what we get. Okay, we have all our labels lined up, but how come we created the constraints the same way that we did in Interface Builder? But now our text fields are really short and over to the right. This is related to the difference that I was telling you about between the way that Interface Builder creates priorities by default and the way that code does. So by default, Interface Builder will create a content hugging priority of 251 in the horizontal direction for labels, and that will cause the labels to hug their content and the text fields to take up the extra space. But when we created them in code, they both have a content hugging priority of 250. And so it's allowing the label to grow and the text field shrinks to its content over on the right. Let's fix that. Because we have our labels constrained to each other, we only need to fix it for one label and the rest of them will line up. So we set the content hugging priority to 251 for the horizontal axis. And our view looks correct.
Well, that's it for this video tutorial. As always, we like to leave you with a challenge. For this challenge, you're going to take this view that you created previously in Interface Builder and convert it to using UI Layout Guide and NS Layout Anchor. All the details are in the challenge document. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.